Our politics lead now. President Trump is spending his final weeks in office ignoring the scale of the COVID crisis publicly. Instead, he is defying every shred of evidence, insisting even today that he won the election and we're rounding the curve. Neither are true. As Kaitlan Collins reports, the outgoing president is consumed by the fight to overturn the election results.
Victory. Thank you very much.
Still fuming about the election, President Donald Trump compared the U.S. to a third world country today as he appeared to acknowledge that his legal efforts to change the results have gone nowhere.
Now, this was like from a third world nation, and I think the case has been made, and now we find out what we can do about it.
But the case hasn't been made. Trump and his allies have lost or withdrawn at least 40 court cases since the election. Now sources tell CNN that between those court losses, some fast approaching deadlines, and his top attorney being hospitalized with coronavirus, the president's legal efforts might end soon.
Well, I think the case has already been made if you look at the polls.
There were two more blows to the president's efforts today. Federal judges in Michigan threw out the latest attempt to overturn the result there, calling Trump ally Sidney Powell's lawsuit, quote, nothing but speculation and conjecture. And the state of Georgia recertified its results after counting presidential ballots for a third time and affirming Joe Biden's win once again, despite what President Trump claimed during a rally there Saturday night.
You know, we won Georgia, just so you understand.
As he awarded the Medal of Freedom to wrestling legend Dan Gable today, Trump attempted to compare their records and wrongly claimed he had won two presidential elections.
Well, you know, in politics, I won two, so I'm 2-0, and that's pretty good too. But we'll see how that turns out.
Trump also provided an update on his personal attorney, Rudy Giuliani's condition after the 76-year-old was admitted to Georgetown University Medical Center with coronavirus.
Rudy's doing well. I just spoke to him. He's doing very well. No temperature.
Giuliani has been crisscrossing the country to push Trump's baseless claims about the election, and he often greeted people with a handshake and no mask. While Trump has refused to acknowledge Biden's win or even call the next president, CNN has learned he's already plotting his next steps. And some staffers are now speculating he may not return to the White House after going to Florida for the Christmas holidays, though no final decisions have been made. And Jake, there are some people who believe there's no way the president doesn't come back to the White House after the Christmas break because, of course, he's been trying to get so much done before he does leave office to really burnish his legacy. One place we do know he is going is back to Georgia ahead of that Senate runoff in January to campaign. Though, of course, when he was there on Saturday night, it was a lot more of him talking about his election loss than it was campaigning for those two Republicans who are going to determine which party, of course, controls the Senate.
Yeah, and obviously we're expecting the president to sandwich in a number of pardons as well. Kaitlan Collins, thank you so much. Let's discuss, Abby, President Trump traveling again to Georgia. What else might be next for President Trump if his legal challenges come to an official close?
Well, Jake, I mean, I think all of this really is ultimately about what he does after, he leaves the White House. It's about trying to set up a political committee that will fund his political future down the road. I wouldn't be surprised if, as we've reported, the president considers even just straight up relaunching a sort of re-election bid for 2024 as he is leaving the White House. This is all about trying to make sure that he secures his place within the Republican Party, that he keeps Republican lawmakers who are currently serving in line, understanding that he still has sway over his base. That's what this whole thing is about. And I think that you'll see the president pretty soon after really planting a flag and saying, I am the future of the Republican Party, and warning other Republicans who try to break from him that he's not going anywhere.
Yeah, of course, he is establishing simultaneously as his legacy the fact that he is the worst, sorest loser in American political history. Meanwhile, Ron, while President Trump is largely ignoring this horrific pandemic, at least in his public comments, his lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, has become infected.
Yeah.
So in a weird way, and obviously we all wish the best for Mr. Giuliani, but it's possible that coronavirus will be the downfall of his election fight.
Yeah, you know, he's the clock is running out, and certainly Rudy Giuliani going to the hospital doesn't, help his cause. But the cause has already been sunk by the lack of evidence that has caused him to lose lawsuits all over the country. And it really is striking that both of these things are happening at once, Jake, as you kind of alluded to. I mean, here we are on Pearl Harbor Day. We are having a Pearl Harbor every day in the United States in terms of the number of casualties from the coronavirus. And yet, virtually, I don't think any leading Republican has complained about the president essentially walking away from the fight, leaving Americans on their own to face this as we deal with the highest peaks of this outbreak, in the same way that virtually no Republicans in Congress, even to this point, are calling out the president's poisonous fantasies of voter fraud and suppression that have led to death threats, not only now in Georgia and Arizona against Secretary of State, but kind of a mob of armed protesters outside the home of the Michigan Secretary of State last night. And still Mitch McConnell and Kevin McCarthy can't say this is wrong, this is dangerous, this is not grounded. In fact, really remarkable and ominous about where we are going in terms of our ability to function as one cohesive country.
It's worse than that even, Ron, because Abby, tomorrow, a vaccine denier is going to testify before the Senate Homeland Security Committee. And CNN's now also learning that some of the president's biggest allies on Capitol Hill, his most sycophantic friends, are urging him to not concede even after Biden wins the Electoral College vote next week. Congressman Jim Jordan, Republican of Ohio, telling CNN that this could include a debate over the results on the House floor. And just a reminder, a president-elect Biden not only won the Electoral College significantly, and we'll see that officially, but he won the popular vote margin by 7 million votes, or if not more. What do you make of this, Abby?
The big picture of all of this is a Republican Party that is being swallowed alive by conspiracies and being allowing itself to be completely taken over by that element of its base. We can't, in fact, we can't even really call it that, that it's some sort of, the sort of base element of the Republican Party. This is the party. Sitting United States senators and inviting a vaccine skeptic to come and testify, someone who is pushing hydroxychloroquine, which has been proven to have no impact on the coronavirus, to come before the Senate, even as we are on the cusp of a vaccine that could help us through this pandemic. You've got QAnon supporters being elected to join the Congress. It should not be a surprise then that you have sitting members of the House and the Senate supporting the president in an effort to build a conspiracy theory around this election that he can live off of for the next 4 years. This is now what has become of the Republican Party. And if people don't want that to be the case, they should probably start speaking up about it now.
Ron, what is happening to the Republican Party? Like, where do they go from here?
Yeah, well, look, I mean, this is kind of a form of secession from shared the kind of shared reality in the U.S., where you have this the willingness of virtually all Republicans. Kelly Loeffler, in that debate last night in Georgia, the Georgia Senate debate, refusing to say that Joe Biden won the state, saying that Donald Trump was within his rights to pursue every legal means. He's pursuing extra legal means to try to overturn this election now, trying to pressure the governor to throw out the results of the vote and appoint, have the state legislature appoint electors in his favor. I mean, I don't think you can overstate the extent to which we are watching the Republican Party, I think, refuse to accept that blue America has legitimacy when it outvotes them. It's not as if Donald Trump is an outlier here. The broad range of Congress is supporting him, and a lot of Republican voters are supporting him. 75-80% of Republican of his voters saying the election was stolen. When Joe Biden talks about unifying the country, he's going to have to deal with a Republican Party that is kind of moving in a centrifugal direction far more than it was even under Obama, much less Bill Clinton.